Well, we've been talking about prayer, and in particular, we have been talking about the model prayer. Last week, we began a series on the disciples' prayer, and I told you the disciples' prayer or model prayer was a better name than the Lord's Prayer. And as we looked at the prayer last week, what we understood was that the first five words where Jesus says to them that our Father who art in heaven, who is in heaven, and that was a kind of an introduction. It's kind of like an invocation. And we learned from that that God is both intimate and personal. He is our Father, but He is also infinitely beyond us. He is in heaven, and we learned about His transcendence. Now, that opened the way for the rest of this prayer. The rest of this prayer is what we're going to be looking at today. And I want you to open your Bible. We're going to be looking at the prayer. Each time we're looking at we're going to read the whole prayer, although we're going to look at just one part of it. And here today, what we find in Matthew in chapter 6, it says, "Pray then in this way, Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Now, what we learned last week and we reemphasized is this prayer was given as a pattern of prayer. It was not given to be recited, and it's amazing how prayer is amazing in its brevity and its scope. In the Greek language, I went back, took my Greek test, and I counted the words, 73 words. That's all there are in this prayer. And what we find, it is so simple even in its structure. It's two sections here in the body of the prayer. There are three petitions that focus on God and His glory, and there are three petitions that focus on man and his needs. And so what we find is that Jesus reversed the order from how people normally do prayers. Normally, we start out praying for ourselves and then eventually get to praying for others, and maybe we'll get to praying thanking God. But that's not what Jesus does. Notice what He says here. He begins, and this first petition, hallowed be thy name. He talks about your name and then your kingdom and then your will. So He focuses on God and then upon man's needs. That's when He gets give us, forgive us, guide us and deliver us from the evil one. So the whole idea here is that we need to begin with God. Worship and prayer must begin with our focus and our attention on God, the one to whom we are praying and to whom we come. Now, our temptation is to focus on ourselves, upon our needs, and we start out with what we need. And consequently, many of our prayers, if not most of them, they get into a wish list. We have our desires. We have the things that we want. And our praying is to convince God that we need those things. But what we're learning here in this prayer is that our focus needs to be on God and not upon ourselves. Effective and fulfilling prayer focuses on God, not on self. Now, when I'm saying that, it's easy to say that, but I want to tell you it is very, very difficult to do because we're so self-centered, we're so self-oriented. We still labor in this flesh, and consequently, it makes it difficult. So I want us to begin this morning looking at this first petition, and I call it the preeminent petition because everything else flows out of it. Hallowed be thy name. Well, if God's name is hallowed, then His kingdom is going to come and His will is going to be done. They're connected. And so what we find here is that Jesus said, pray this way, hallowed be thy name. In the original language, that verb is in a passive tense, which has the idea of let your name be hallowed. And the idea is it is God Himself who must hallow or who must make holy His name. And so that's what this request is. Now, we can participate, and we need to. We need to work or let God work through us to bring glory and to His name. But the goal, the objective here is for God to be recognized and God to be glorified throughout the whole world when he talks about hallowed be thy name. So now, two questions. What does it mean to say hallowed be thy name? And secondly, how do we go about doing that? How can we hallow God's name? Well, first of all, let's talk about what it means to be hallowed. You use this word every day, don't you? Hallowed. It's an archaic term that we seldom ever use. And if you've got a modern translation, it will say sanctify or it'll say make holy. The idea, the root word in the original language has to be set apart. Lord, let people recognize that you are so different from us. Hallowed be your name. Sanctified be your name. Those things associated with God are called holy, set apart. For example, the Sabbath. In the Old Testament, it says in Exodus 28, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. It's set apart. It's set apart for time with God. What we're doing today, being in worship time. Our time of worship should be hallowed, set apart to God. And we need to focus upon him and allow him to speak to us. Not only that, but the priests in the Old Testament were set apart. In Leviticus 21:8, we read, regard them as holy, talking about the priest, because they offer up the food of your God. Consider them holy, because I, the Lord, am holy, I who make you holy. And so the idea here is when we attach this word holy and associate it with God, it means that we're to be set apart. That's the reason you are to be holy. You have been set apart. You belong to God. And the New Testament teaches that. We're to be holy. Set apart to God. That doesn't mean that we're sinless or perfect or pure. What it means is that we are set apart to God and we're growing toward that reality. Now, the Jews set God's name apart. I mean, they really set it apart. I mean, what you'll find is that they would not say the name God. They substituted another word, Adonai, Lord. And they circumvented the name that God gave Moses. You know, there are four letters in that name. YHWH, those four consonants. But what they did was they coined a word, we call it Jehovah. They took the vowels off of Adonai, added them to those consonants, and that's where you get Jehovah. And so they used that name rather than the four consonants, the name that God gave to Moses. To hallow God's name means to give him the glory and the honor that he deserves. When we're talking about setting it apart, means recognizing that God is wholly different. It is so inappropriate for us to speak in terms of this God in lowly or, you know, everyday language. For example, some people say, well, you know, our heavenly grandfather. God's not a grandfather. And he ain't the old man upstairs. I mean, when we use those kinds of terms, we are decreasing the glory of God. We need to recognize him. Jesus is teaching us, when you start out, you need to understand who God is, and you need to honor him in that way. Peter taught us in the book of 1 Peter 3:15, but sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account of the hope that's in you. Sanctify Christ in your heart. So what we need to do is, in our spiritual being, in our inner being, we need to acknowledge God and set him apart in that way. We profane the name of God when we take his name in vain or we take it and use it carelessly. Years ago, I worked on a pipeline. And when I was working on the pipeline, it was a constant barrage of GD. It was a constant situation where someone would declare, well, Jesus Christ. I mean, they had no idea about God. They were not acknowledging God. They have just reduced the name of God to that kind of use, and it profanes the name of God. We do the same thing. When we use the name God, when we acknowledge that, we need to know who we're talking to. I've heard people say something like this, well, I swear to God. They're not swearing to God. They're not even thinking about God. And so my whole point here is, Jesus is saying, when you use the name for God, You need to understand it is very different. It is not common. It is not something that we can use that way. We need to, when we think about him, when we talk about him, we need to glorify him in our lives. So, God's name is hallowed, I believe, when we obey him. That is to say, he is sovereign God. He is the Lord of the whole universe. We learned that last week. He's who is in heaven, but he's also a loving heavenly Father. He loves you and me. Now, the fact is that all of us have sinned. We rebelled against him. But God, in his infinite love and grace and mercy, came to us and drew us to him. And now, as he has redeemed us back, he wants you and me to be a glory to him. He wants to use you and me to demonstrate his glory. And that's kind of what we're talking about here this morning. God has to do this work. I told you earlier it was in a passive tense. God has to work through us to glorify his name. Jesus acknowledged that. Listen to what he says in John 17. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you've given me to do. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had before the world was. And so the whole idea is we need to glorify, honor, hallow, set apart, sanctify the name of God. I like the way James Montgomery Boyce paraphrased this. He said this petition, hallowed be thy name, could be paraphrased like this. My Father in heaven, my first desire is that in everything you might have the preeminence. And that's the whole idea, acknowledging him. And so we talk a little bit about hallowed. What about the name? Hallowed be your name. There's so much more than most of us even begin to think about when Jesus says, hallowed be your name. I mean, in the Hebrew understanding, the name signified the character and the nature of whatever was named. And so God's name is synonymous with his being, who he actually is. And so the name then, and God has revealed himself through his names. You know, names have meaning. My wife, Dorothy, we were in a restaurant the other day, and this lady came over and she had Dot on her thing. I said, your name Dot? And she said, yep. I said, well, her name is Dot too. She's Dorothy. And the girl, lady said, well, my name's Dorothy too. I said, well, do you know what it means? She said, no. I said, well, Dorothy comes from two Greek words, doron, which means gift, and theos, which means God. And so she said it before I did. She said, so my name means gift of God. I said, that's exactly right. And Dorothy has been a gift of God to me. By the way, she's not able to be with me these last weeks. She's 7 weeks now out of the gallbladder surgery, but she just doesn't have any strength and energy. Pray for her that she can get some strength and energy. She goes back to our primary physician Tuesday, and hopefully he'll get us some answer here. But names, we're talking about names. You know, in the Bible, people had their names changed. Jacob, who was a supplanter, deceiver, was changed to Israel. You know, leader of the nation of Israel. Peter was Simon, but then Jesus says, no, I'm going to make you a rock. And he named him Peter. So names have meaning. And God has names. All through the Bible, what you find is God has been revealing himself. And he has revealed himself. One of the primary ways is through his name and through his actions. It's rather interesting to read the account in the book of Exodus. If you have a time later, go back and read Exodus 33 and 34. Now, when you do that, what you're going to find is that in verse 18 of chapter 33, Moses asked God, let me see your glory. And God says, you cannot. Man cannot look on the face of God. And he said, but I'll tell you what, I want you to go. I'm going to put you in this little cleft of this rock. I'm going to put my hand over you, and then I'm going to walk by you, and I'm going to declare my name. Here's what he says. I myself will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious and will show compassion on whom I will show compassion. And so God put his hand over him, and God went by, and then He took his hand off of him so that he could see the hind parts. He said, "You'll see my backside, but if you saw my face, it wouldn't last. I mean, it'd kill you." So the whole idea is, he said, "I'm gonna pass by. I'm gonna show you." And look in verse 30, chapter 34, and verse 6. Then the Lord passed by in front of him and proclaimed, "The Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in loving kindness and truth." Now, what is God's name coming out of that? Well, he says, "I'm revealing to you my character." He says, "I am gracious, compassionate, slow to anger. I mean, abounding in loving kindness and truth." And the name that was associated with that is a name that we talked about earlier, those four consonants. We'll talk about it a little bit more in a minute. But the whole point is, that's the nature of God that he's revealed. What kind of a God do you serve? I mean, do you serve, as I said last week, some kind of tyrant? Some judge that's, you know, ready to zap you? Or someone who is distant? No, we serve a God who is caring about each one of us. And it's so important, I think, for us to realize this. And so the idea is, God says, "I have revealed myself." Jesus says the same thing in John 17. He says in verse 6, "I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word." NIV translates it this way: "I revealed you to those that you gave to me." God has revealed himself supremely in the person of Jesus Christ. I think that God's greatest name is Lord Jesus Christ. He is sovereign. He is Savior. He is the coming King. And we need to understand that all of that's wrapped up in, set apart is your name. Lord, when we think about the name, we ought not think just about an identity, but we need to think about the character. God has revealed himself in so many powerful ways. Names in the Old Testament, for example. The first name of God, you know what it is? It's Elohim. It is the plural form of El, which is God, but it is associated with creation. It's plural because of the Trinity, I believe, although there are others that think it's just because of majesticness. But the idea is that he is Elohim, and it connotes strength and power because he is the creator. And it has the idea of his dominion and his power. So when we use the name Elohim, and it's always used with reference to creation, God as that kind of a God, that is who he is. And there are many places where when the men of the Old Testament began their prayers, they acknowledged God as Elohim, the creator, the one who made all of us. So that's one of the names. And there are combinations of El that are used as well. El Shaddai, God Almighty. They're like that. But the second name that is of importance to us is the name that I explained earlier, and that is the name of Jehovah, those four consonants. Those four consonants, YHWH, are the, in the Hebrew, that's the form of the verb to be. And so it has the connotation of I am. You remember that Jesus talked about I am, the I am statements? He is that God. He is that one. It's one who is self-existent. There never has been a time when he was not. And he has chosen to reveal himself with that name. And then specifically, it's related to an event. When Moses said to God, "Whom shall I say sent me?" Talking about going, leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. He says, "Whom shall I say sent me?" And that's when he gives him the name. And so the name Jehovah is connected to redemption and to the deliverance of Israel from that bondage. So the idea then, when we use the name Yahweh or Jehovah, which the same basic name, then we're talking about God as being the one who has saved us and the one who delivers us. Now, there are many, and tonight we'll have a listing of a lot more of these names, but just a couple of them that will help you to understand or get a feel for this. Jehovah, the name, this four-letter name, Jehovah Jireh. You know that name? J-I-R-E-H. Jehovah Jireh. That's the God who provides. Where did that come from? Well, that name came at Mount Moriah. You remember that Abraham was going to kill Isaac as a sacrifice because God had told him to go there and do that. But God held his hand, and then a ram was there, and he took the ram. And so God's name, Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. When the time comes and the need is great, God will provide. And it applied in that situation with him, but it applies in our lives as well. That's the name of God. He has provided miraculously at times in my life, and I'm sure many of you could amen that. Not only that, but he is Jehovah Rapha. He is the God who heals, my healer. Do you know where that came from? When they came out of Egypt, they were headed into the wilderness. They came to the place called Marah, bitter. The water was bitter. And so God told them what to do. They cut down these bushes, put it in the water. It turned sweet. And that's where the name comes from, Jehovah Rapha, the healer. God healed the water. It wasn't physical healing, although God is more than capable of doing that, as we well know. But the point is that God will take care of situations when we can't handle them. He's the healer. And not only that, but he is the Lord our peace. That name comes from Gideon. When Gideon was called to lead Israel against the enemy and to deliver them, he was hesitant. But God revealed himself through the angel or through the epiphany in the Old Testament. And the name then, God says, I'm going to give you peace. I'm going to bring peace. And he did it through Gideon. And so the name Jehovah Shalom is the name for the peace here. So these names, all of these names reflect the character of God, the actions of God in situations, the nature of God. And so when we see the name, we're to think in terms of who he is and what he's done. I think one of my favorites is that Old Testament scripture in Isaiah, where he says in verse 6 of chapter 9, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And Jesus fulfilled every one of those. And so when we talk about the name, he's saying, set apart, sanctified, recognize your name. He's talking about all of these qualities, and so we need to understand what it means to hallow the name of God. Now, you do realize that Jesus, as the perfect fulfiller of all the Old Testament prophecies, has a name. In fact, what it says that he's going to have a name in Philippians 2:9, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. And that's the reason I said earlier, I think God's greatest name is Lord Jesus Christ. That's the name at which every knee has to bow. And we need to do that now. Don't wait until ultimately everybody's going to have to acknowledge who he is. But he is inviting you and me to do it now, to yield to him now, to surrender our life to him now, to confess him as Lord and Master in our life now, so that we can live with him and for him all the days of our life. So then, how can we hallow the name of God? Jesus was saying here, Lord, work in such a way that your name will be exalted in us. He wanted all men to value the glory of God, to acknowledge the holiness of God, and to treasure God above everything else. That's the whole idea here. What is the most important thing in our life? It ought to be God. It ought to be putting him first in everything. And so, how can we do that? Well, I think part of it, as I said earlier, when you say, hallowed be thy name, and then he follows with, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, he is telling us how. His name is hallowed when we bring in the kingdom, when we let his will be done. And he does that through the body. He does that through his body, the church. And so as we carry out the assignment that we have been given, Jesus said in John 17:4, I have glorified you by accomplishing the work that you gave me to do. And then Jesus in John says, as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. So if you and I are going to bring glory to his name, how do we do that? Well, I think one of the primary ways, if not the primary way, is to bring other people to know him. God's desire is for all men everywhere to acknowledge who he is. And we do that through what we call evangelism. Sharing the gospel, telling other people about him. But I think we also hallow the name of God when we acknowledge who he is and what he's done. Like we did this morning, praying for Sam, praying for answered prayer, giving thanks to God. When we acknowledge God, you are a great and magnificent God. You have done beyond anything that we could imagine. We give you glory. We give you honor. You're the one who deserves all praise. And I think, my friends, we need to spend a lot more time doing that than we do. I think that's a part of how we hallow the name of God. We begin by adoring God. That's how you hallow him. You adore him for who he is and what he's done. Tonight at 5 o'clock, we're going to have a special time of prayer. And it's a concert of prayer for our nation. And we're going to begin that hour from 5 to 6. We're going to begin it by acknowledging who God is. We're going to follow the pattern of Isaiah chapter 6, where Isaiah saw God high and lifted up. And we're going to spend time adoring God. We're going to spend time blessing God. We're going to spend time acknowledging who he is. Before we ever get to what's on my heart and the burden that I have and you have as well about saying, God, we desperately need you to move in this nation. God, we are at a point that we cannot make it without you. We're going to say that tonight. But before we ever get there, we're going to say, God, you're the God who's answered prayer. You delivered Israel. Lord, you have been our strength in times past. We bless you. We're going to spend some time acknowledging him. And that, I think, is what Jesus is teaching us about prayer. Where does prayer begin? It begins with God. And when we acknowledge who he is, that's the proper spirit. We come to God with reverence. We come to God with humility. But we come with absolute confidence because he is our loving heavenly Father. But I think another way that, and a way that I'm seeking to do it myself, and I trust you will want to do the same thing, and that is we hallow God by being conscious of his presence all the time. Being mindful, whatever you're doing, that God is with you in it, and asking him, Lord, help me to do whatever it is I'm doing here the way you want it, and let you get glory from it. David, the psalmist, said in Psalm 16:8, I keep the Lord in mind always. I keep the Lord in mind always. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. And as we face whatever the circumstances are, when we are mindful and conscious of his presence with us, we do not have to fear or be concerned. And so, to hallow God's name is to live with a consciousness of his presence and to see things from his perspective. Be mindful of him constantly. Paul wrote the Colossians and he said this, whatever you do, and I'm assuming that's everything from the time you wake up in the morning until you go to bed at night, whatever you do, he says, do everything, whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God through the Father, through him. In other words, so mindful, always conscious of, Lord, what I'm doing right now, let it bring glory to you. Help me to accomplish what I'm striving to accomplish, and I give you glory for it, but let it add to your kingdom work and what you're trying to do. And so, what I'm understanding is, we can join in, we can participate in the hallowing of God's name by allowing God to work through us and in these ways. And not only that, God, I believe, is sanctified, set apart, hallowed, made holy when we obey him, when we are obedient to his calling and unto our life. Jesus says, confess me before men. We need to confess him before men. I mean, the Word of God teaches us that we're to confess our sins, 1 John 1:9. And so that's a part. When you're acknowledging, when you're saying the same thing about sin that God does and you're repenting of it, that brings glory to God, even though you've made a mess. Not only that, but we need to bear fruit. It's God's will that we bear much fruit. We'll look at this more next week. And fruit that remains. When we do that, it brings glory to God. God is honored. He is magnified in those situations. So Jesus said, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works, but look at the rest of it, and give glory to your Father in heaven. They see what we do, but they give glory to God when they understand that what God is working through us to accomplish whatever it is that we are doing. And I think that's how we set apart and hallow the name of God. Have you ever thought about the fact that there are consequences when you don't hallow God? When you and I profane the name of God, when we disobey God, are there consequences? Yes, there are. And a prime example is in the life of Moses. I mean, the reality is that God spoke to Moses, and he tells him in Numbers 20, verse 8, take the staff, and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together, speak to that rock before their eyes, and it will pour out water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community so that they and their livestock can drink. Now, that's what God told them to do. But what did Moses do? Well, it's in verse 11. Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. God says, speak to the rock. Moses struck the rock twice with a staff. Why did he do that? I think he did it because he's just like us, or we're just like him. He was going back. He had used that staff in the past. He did what he had done before, and he expected. But God was teaching him new things, and we need to be open to God teaching us new things. But we need to be obedient to what God says. The power was not in the staff. See, that's the problem he had, and that's the problem we have. It's not in what we have done in the past that makes us successful. It is what, even though that may have succeeded, it's God's leadership. And the consequence was in verse 12. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I gave them. Is it possible that you and I have not received what we wanted or what we felt like we needed because we have not hallowed the name of God as we should? I don't know. I don't know what's going on. I just know this. God's name will be hallowed. Ultimately, everyone is going to acknowledge it. So my purpose here today is not to frighten us, but to bring us to the realization that we are engaged. When we talk about prayer, we're engaging with a living God. And we need to understand we're standing on sacred ground in the presence of God. And we need to remember also that the ultimate objective in prayer is not to get what we want, but rather to bring us in harmony with what God wants. I love the way Joel said it. God answered our prayers in a way different than we thought. He changed us. And that's what we need. We need to be open to letting God move in our life. God wants to bless us. He loves you. He wants to bless you. But if you and I do not obey Him, if we do not do what He's asked us to do, then we cannot expect that blessing. Will you this morning say, God, as best I'm able, from this day forward, I will commit myself to honor, glorify, magnify, exalt, hallow your name. Will you do that? Let's bow together. In just a moment, I'm going to give you a chance to respond to whatever God's telling you to do. But it occurred to me that it may be that the way you need to hallow God's name today is by yielding your life to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. If you've never done that, then you cannot hallow God's name if you have not taken that first step. Would you say yes to Jesus? Would you say, Jesus, come into my heart, my life, forgive my sin, and fill me with yourself, your spirit, so that I can live for you and honor you? If you need to do that, do it right now. In a moment, I'm going to give the people here in the sanctuary an opportunity to respond, come forward. But if you're at home, just punch the connect button, and that will put you in touch with someone that can give you guidance and direction. But I'm thinking that the majority of us already know Christ, but we need to recommit ourselves to hallow His name in the way we live every day. And if that be the case right now, just take time to tell Him that. Heavenly Father, we bless you, we praise you, we thank you for your presence with us. And we pray now that, Lord, your name would be exalted and lifted up. That, Father, each one of us in this time of response will say yes to you, and by our very obedience, Lord, become a part of hallowing your name. May your will be done in every heart and every life. In Jesus' name, amen.